Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown, because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive. Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section. I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Age of Radio.
Hold on, you can't come in here.
I'm coming in. I'm sitting down at the microphone.
Who is it? What?
Wait, boys, I try. He's a menace.
We need to talk to you. It's I, Richard Harris.
Oh boy.
I think I've been on your show before. I think a long time ago. I don't know. My memory's not so good being dead.
Well, hello, Mr. Harris. You forced your way in. You just about killed Jimmy Stewart there.
Yeah.
I mean, and he's already dead, so that's pretty forceful.
I needed to talk to you, because I know today, and I know normally on the show, because I do listen, fellas. I do listen to the show.
Well, thanks, Dickie. I appreciate it.
It's a very good show, but I'm telling you, today you're watching a Harry Potter movie, and you're watching the third one. Do you know what's special about the third one, you daft-bearded prick? Wait, which one are you talking about, me or him? Yep! Both of you! You're both daft-bearded pricks!
Okay, well, Mr. Harris, I mean, it is the third film. It is directed by Alfonso Cuaron. It is the first darker Harry Potter movie. I don't know what else you could possibly be referring to.
The fact that it was the first one made after I died! And they recast me role!
Wait, are you upset about that?
Ah! I was very upset because they recast me with Michael Gambon.
No, wait.
Do you know Michael Gambon?
Mr. Harris.
Aye.
You,
yes.
They were going to get Ian McKellen, but he didn't want to do it because you said he was a terrible actor.
Well, he is. He's a good man. He's a fine cook, but he's not much of an actor.
That's a hot take.
No, the reason I told them, when I was on my deathbed, Mr. Brendan, I said... If you do these movies, take all the things I've said, recut them together, and use computer graphics, you understand, to rebuild me, so I can continue to play Albus Dumbledore, because it's the most stirring character I've ever played, you know.
Right.
There's a darkness in him that is reminiscent of that dude from The Sporting Life. Was I in that one? I think I was in that one.
Well, you were in Unforgiven.
Yes, I was English Bob, of course. Point is, Michael Gambon, lovely man, We partied in the 60s. I've been to an orgy or two with the fella, I'll tell you that. He's a good man, but he can't act his way out of a paper bag. And he took me character, and he turned it into a pile of shit.
Well,
you understand? Shit.
Mr. Harris, if it makes you feel any better, with the strength of your memory, you were in this sporting life. I just wanted to let you know that.
Ah, 'twas a long time ago, and it was when I was alive, and it's hard to remember things. Anyways, why was I here? I don't remember.
You're just really angry at Michael Gambon, but what about the rest of the movie,
Mr.
Harris?
Ah, yes, Michael Gambon. Fuck Michael Gambon, right in his Gambon.
Okay. Okay, is there anything else you want to say about this Harry Potter movie?
All I'm saying, go back and fix it. George Lucas this shit is what I'm saying.
Are you telling Jason and I to do that?
Yeah, because we're not really effects artists. That's a lot of money we don't have. No, not you fucking idiots. No, I'm saying out to the world, because I know the world listens to your podcast, okay?
Okay.
All I'm saying is fix it. Take him out, put me in. I'm dead, I don't care. Make your money. I just want there to be a consistency to what I believed was going to be my magnum opus, you see, for me grandkids. Mm. For me grandkids. Mm-hmm. We're probably in their 30s now, so fuck them. Well, but I still want
Mr. Harris, may I suggest your family make friends with Topher Grace? He apparently likes recutting things. He could help them out.
Oh, I once sent Jared over to his house when Topher was no more than 7 or 8 and Jared was in his late 40s.
Okay, sure.
And what I'm saying is my son is very old.
Yes, of course.
He's very old.
Yes.
Not as old as I am, but that's, you know, by definition.
All right, that's it. You got to get out of here, Richard.
Oh, Jimmy Stewart. I always liked Vertigo, but I never liked you in it.
Oh, you son of a bitch. You got the heave-ho.
Oh, he just slapped him in the face a bunch of times.
He just slapped him in the face a bunch of times. Yeah, what's up with that? Jimmy, just get him out. Just be quiet.
Well, I'm giving him the jetpack treatment. Off you go. See you in hell.
He kicked him right in the jetpack and it went off. And Sir Richard Harris, was he a sir? Probably not, because he's Irish. It flew over the horizon.
I'll tell you something. He's a son of a bitch.
Well, there you go. Thank you for joining us for our discussion of Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. Guys, this is a podcast.
Technically, yes.
It's technically a podcast because we talk into microphones. It goes onto the internet. People listen to it in theory. And then we just move on to the next week. This is called For Screen.
And Gundre.
And I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
And on this show, we talk about British films. More specifically, we're talking about the Empire Top 100 British movies of all British time. Now, we've already talked about the BFI Top 100 British movies. We're now talking about this list, because what we're going to do is we're going to combine lists. We're going to make our own list. We're going to take some of those old fogies off the BFI Top 100, maybe put some of these new sexy British movies on there in their place. And we're going to...
It has been, Brendan, 23 years since the British Film Institute last put out their list of the top 100 British films, and they have been lax. They have not put out a new list yet. That's a long time. Brendan, I'm 38 years old. In 1999, I was in ninth grade.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You understand?
And I wasn't even born yet.
No. Wait. That's not true. Anyways, point is, it's been a long time, and if these stuffy old assholes aren't going to do it, then, well, it's clearly up to us.
It clearly is. As to Canadian residents, it's clearly up to us to update the British film list of British movies, of British...
Who better, Brendan, British. To tell the British what their best movies are than you and me?
Well, I mean, technically, we all used to be buds.
We still are.
Well,
we're part of the Commonwealth. The Queen of England is also the Queen of Canada.
I believe the Queen of Canada is Ramona or whatever the fuck her name is.
What, the lady that got the free RV recently?
Yeah.
Yeah, her. No, the real queen, the one with the crown, crown of diamonds
it's not the one. Wait, so you're telling me the Queen of Canada is not the one that's telling people to shoot healthcare workers?
She has not. Oh, I was going to say, the Queen of Canada, of course, has been ordained by God to be the monarch. But yes, no, the other Queen of Canada, that's just
That's more of a fun. That's a fun name for just among friends, right?
Mm. What a fun character. And so Jason, this week we're talking about our next movie on the Empire Top 100 list, and it's a big one. We're talking about Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. But before we talk about that and we dive in, we need to read some comments regarding last week's movie that we discussed. And that was, of course, Locke.
Stock. And two.
Smoking.
Barrels.
And this is me talking. Yes. This is me talking. Movies, 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 movies. Movies.
We are recording.
I like movies. They're good. They make me want to watch other movies. Okay. What do we do after Lockstock? Harry Potter, I think it was, but I'm going to double check. I never know this. I should always check this, but I never do. It is Harry Potter. Okay. Before we talk about Harry Potter, Prisoner of Azkaban, we need to read some comments from last week's movie, Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels. And Jason, what a barrel of comments we have.
This guy here, folks, this is why you listen, to get these kind of transitions.
We've got a lock, a stock, and a two smoking barrels of comments.
Smoking! Barrels.
Yeah, that's what you come here for the 1995 references. You stay for the refreshments.
That's our wheelhouse, Brendan.
Jason, we got comments. Let's start off. I am going to read Ben L. Connor's comment about Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels. Says, I was obsessed with this movie when it came out. It was like a Tarantino film, except, like, fun and with likable characters. I think Snatch has the slight edge on this, being more expansive and chaotic, but this is still brilliant. I don't know if it's a snipe on Tarantino or if it just means his characters are not likable and the movies are still good, but hey,
I do describe his movies as fun. I enjoy them. They're fun for me to watch.
Yeah.
But I agree with everything else. Yes, they're great. Yeah, yeah. Snatch stuff certainly has the edge in my mind, but I haven't watched it in a while. We'll see.
That might change one day. Spoiler alert. Who else chimed in, Jason?
The next comment, Brendan, comes from one James Parsons, who writes, I enjoy it more than Snatch, even though it's a little wonky and less polished. My favorite, actually, is the first RDJ Sherlock Holmes. Big budget IP done right. I've only seen clips of that movie, Brendan, and it does seem very Guy Ritchie.
From what I remember, it's pretty good. It's been a long time. I think the last time I saw it was the first time I saw it, and that was in theaters.
Ah.
I remember the people being punched and them doing it in like slow motion with their faces moving and stuff. That's the biggest thing I remember from those movies.
Yeah, me too. And I've just seen clips. So we'll take your word for it. James Parsons.
Pride and Prejudice expert extraordinaire Sharon Horwat chimes in and says, I remember really enjoying this when I watched it a few years back. It was a great launching pad for Ritchie and all the actors in it, Dexter Fletcher being my favorite. Of course, he played Soap. Right? Yes.
That is correct.
And the ending makes it a great double feature with the OG Italian Job. Yes, thank you, Sharon. I mentioned that one last week. I'm so glad someone else mentioned it. Of the Guy Ritchie films, Man from U.N.C.L.E. and The Gentlemen were my favorites, but I haven't hated the ones I have seen.
Very nice.
Man from U.N.C.L.E. is an underrated one. People should watch it.
I did not see that.
It's pretty good. Got Henry Cavill in it.
Oh, you enjoy him. Our next comment, Brendan, comes from Theo Maddox, who writes, I cautiously think Lock, Stock, and Snatch are two very cool films. I didn't really like The Rock and Roller or The Gentleman very much, but they were good enough to watch.
With that,
it's
amazing how he wrote with that intonation.
I'm just nailing it, Brendan. I actually really like his Sherlock Holmes films, particularly the first one. I also like The Man from U.N.C.L.E., but I need a rewatch. I have not seen Man from U.N.C.L.E., as we stated previously, and I've only seen clips of Sherlock Holmes. I feel like I did watch Rock and Rolla, but I don't remember a single fucking thing about it.
Definitely didn't watch Rock and Rolla. We did cover The Gentleman, though, and that was pretty good.
Yes, that was fine. Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Ben Piper says, Snatch is his best. Guy Ritchie just isn't a very good director, though. Some entertaining films, but nothing really distinctive beyond the Cockney accents. Otherwise, pretty derivative of Get Carter and more talented crime gangster filmmakers and films.
Can you name a director outside of the guy that did that fucking Behind Enemy Lines that is as hyperkinetic as Guy Ritchie? Like maybe the who directed the Kingsman movie? That was pretty hyperkinetic at times.
Matthew Vaughn,
yeah, an acolyte of Guy Ritchie, of course. So yes, Matthew Vaughn certainly. He's learned from at Guy Ritchie's knee, but yeah, I mean, I don't think it's fair to say he doesn't have his own style. I think he is pretty distinctive. I think when you see like something like Snatch, you're just like, oh, that's Guy Ritchie.
yeah. I mean, I think we talked about the Tarantino similarities, but I think he is still very different from everyone else.
But Tarantino can have bursts of energy in his movies, and he often does. But that's not. It's not like Guy Ritchie. It's not like that constant. Like he loves to, because he likes Sergio Leone and spaghetti westerns. He likes to take his time sometimes and like pull back and take a moment to breathe.
Are you saying there Quentin Tarantino movies have scenes of like long scenes of dialogue?
Long scenes of dialogue and sometimes silence.
Huh.
Hmm. Jackie Brown.
Who's next besides Goldberg's next victim?
Try that again. Nate Shue writes, Brendan, Guy Ritchie loves remaking the same film over and over, and this is probably the best because it's the freshest.
All right. Fair enough, Nate. Anders B. says, I love Lock, Stock, Snatch, Man from U.N.C.L.E., Sherlock Holmes, and The Gentleman. He's got some real crap heaps in his filmography, but he has a unique style, particularly with his London gangster films. Given some time, Rock and Rolla has grown on me a lot. Sometimes he's over-stylized, but I will always respect his takes on the London gangster genre. I do think it's funny that nobody has mentioned in the slew of great movies that he's done, nobody's mentioned Swept Away yet.
Yeah, that's surprising that they wouldn't have brought that one up.
I mean, that's the first one that comes to my mind. All right, take us home, Jason. Last comment.
The last comment, Brendan, comes from one Scott Ellis, who writes, Love Lock, Stock felt real, and Snatch was just an Americanized rehash. Funny thing is, I saw it in theaters in the U.S. and then saw it on tape a month later while studying in the U.K. First realization of the differences between movie schedules in Europe/U.S. No, that's cool, though, because back then that was a thing. Like, yeah, movies would come out at different times in different regions. And of course, in the U.K., the tapes were all PAL. So even if you went to the trouble of importing, you'd have to have a proper VCR and TV to make it work.
Now, I also don't remember Snatch that well because it's been a while, but I feel like this is maybe a fair critique saying it's more Americanized, at least that part of it. I feel like it probably is.
I feel like it's Americanized in the sense that it has a couple of Americans in it.
It's got Dennis Farina. It's
Dennis
got Brad Farina
Pitt. As an American character, and then Brad Pitt in Traveler Face.
I do remember Dennis Farina having a lot of funny moments in the movie.
Oh, yeah. No, he's great.
Like
he's
saying
wonderful.
That he's just complaining about being in London the whole time.
Yeah. The food here sucks.
Yeah. No, RIP. Great actor. Yep. And on that bright, wonderful note,
yep.
We're gonna move on now. We're going to talk about this week's movie, and that is, of course, Harry Potter and the Prisoner of...
Azkaban. Bye, 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 bye. Harry Potter, you're a boy in a closet with no escape, and then an owl takes you off to a school. I think that's what happened. The owl grabbed his shoulders and carried him across to the train station, and he got on a train, and it's like, why didn't the owl carry him to Mordor so he could destroy the ring? Harry Potter.
That weirdly Russian-tinged theme song can only mean one thing. Jason, we are talking about, of course, Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban, the third installment in the Harry Potter film franchise. The third of what? Seven?
Yeah, well, eight films.
Okay.
Seven books, eight films.
Eight films. But are we counting the part one and two as two separate films, right?
Well, I believe so. I believe the other Harry Potter on this list is specifically part two, is it not?
Yeah, number eight, the eighth film. You're right. But yes, Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. Okay, before we even get into anything, I just want to run down this list of cast just to give people an idea of what we're dealing with here, okay?
This is interesting, too. This is great one of the great things about these movies is that it's a film education in many wonderful British actors mm-hmm. who have been in many of the movies we've seen, and it's great that young people get to experience those actors in these performances, and then they'll recognize them later on.
I feel like this cast is as if we did like a fantasy cast based yeah. off of the movies we've watched so far on this podcast.
Yeah, absolutely. Some other nerd who'd watched all the movies on the BFI list was casting Harry Potter.
Yeah, so we've got the main people, Daniel Radcliffe, Rupert Grint, and Emma Watson. We got our main three. We got Robbie Colt.
Have they been, wait, quick question. Have those guys been in any other movies we've watched so far?
No.
It would be in this run now, but I don't think so.
Well, they will be in one other one, obviously, but.
Yeah.
They haven't been okay. so far.
All right.
We've got, of course, Robbie Coltrane as Hagrid. We've seen him pop yes. up a couple times. We have Michael Gambon as Dumbledore, as you heard Richard Harris loudly complaining about earlier.
Yeah. Surely we've seen Michael Gambon in something.
I think we probably have.
I can't think of anything.
We have Richard Griffiths as Vernon Dursley, Harry's uncle, and we've definitely seen him in stuff.
Yeah. What was the movie where he was the gay dude? He was the gay uncle?
Oh, With Nil and I.
Right, with Nolan Eye. Okay.
Yeah. We have Gary Oldman as Sirius Black. We have...
Is this the first time we've seen Gary Oldman in a movie on this list?
No, because we talked about Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy.
Right, that was the first movie we did for this run. Of course.
We have Alan Rickman, of course, the great Alan Rickman. We have Fiona Shaw, Dame Maggie Smith, Timothy Spall, David Thewlis, Emma Thompson, Julie Walters... A plethora of other people, but of course, most importantly, a cameo by the one and the only Miss Julie Christie.
Hello, Julie. Thank you for showing up. It made my day that much better, because back when I originally saw this movie, I had no idea who Julie Christie was.
Right. And now we've seen, like, I don't know, 1,200 Julie Christie movies.
A lot of movies with her. She's wonderful.
And of course, the director of this film is actually someone we've talked about on this podcast before, Jason. Maybe not in a super positive light, but the director of this film, Alfonso Cuaron, of course, known for doing Y Tu Mama Tambien, Gravity, this movie, and a movie we talked about on this podcast, the remake or the adaptation, the 2000, I think it was 19, it was a 2000, I think, adaptation of Great Expectations.
Yeah.
A movie okay. we were like, pretty down on.
Yeah, I barely remember it, so
not great.
I remember it looking kind of nice, and I like the way that Cuaron shoots things. He's very good at that.
Yeah. Well, I'm just gonna lay something out right now for everyone, though, Jason.
Sure.
I don't know about you. I don't know where you're at mm-hmm. with Harry Potter as an entire entity,
mm-hmm.
but I will.
Well, you say, then I'll say.
Well, I will say right now that. I watched all of these movies once a couple years ago. I've never read a single book, so I don't know about, like, you know, I don't know all the backstories for all the characters. I don't know all the things that were, I mean, without researching, I don't know all the things that were left out of the book. I don't know all the things that were that remained in the book to the movies. I don't know anything like that, but I have seen all these movies one time. And this movie a second time. So that is where I am coming in. Jason, tell me what your knowledge is coming into this.
I have read 7 of the 8 books. And I'll tell you why. Because I went to the theater with my friend Gillis in, I think, 2001 when the first movie came out. And we were both in high school. And we were, I think it was a Friday, and we were bored. And we went to the theater. And it was like, oh, that new Harry Potter movie. So you want to go see that? And it's like, yeah, that's a kid's movie. It's like, eh, whatever. It'll kill a couple hours. So we went in with pretty skeptical. And we watched it. And the two of us came out enchanted. we really enjoyed it. It was fantastic. So my buddy Shane, who I have mentioned on other podcasts, his sister had the series. So I said, just give me the next book. Give me the Chamber of Secrets, mm-hmm. and I'll read that. And then I read the rest of them. I never read the first book because I saw the movie, but I read the rest of the series. And I've seen all the movies at least once. I think I saw the first one numerous times, and yeah, this one I've seen twice. So anyways, yeah, I'm a fan of the series. I wouldn't consider myself a super fan like my wife was when she was younger, but I do enjoy them, and I am familiar with the books, though it has been a long time since I've read them, but I will mention a few things that are different. But for the most part, these movies are great adaptations of a book. Like, mm-hmm. there's not a whole lot that gets cut out that you know, needs to be there. Like, it's mostly extraneous details that are nice to read, but don't necessarily need to be there.
Yeah, I mean, there's always that meme, and I think, there's always that meme or that gif or whatever from the Goblet of Fire where it has the passage in the book where Dumbledore asks calmly, did you put your name in the Goblet of Fire? And then the scene from the movie is,
it's also grammatically a weird thing to... It's a weird adverb to use to describe as somebody saying something calmly.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it said calmly, but it's like peacefully or something like
No, it was calmly. Oh, it was calmly? I've seen the passage. It absolutely was calmly.
Okay. Well, and it's great. It's great that you can be a fan of a book series and respect the author so much as a person at the same time.
Well, here's the thing. Let's get this out of the way.
Let's get this out of the way.
Because J.K. Rowling has turned out to be kind of a shit. And
yeah.
Listen,
you had to know something was going to be up. Who names their kid? Just kidding. Just kidding, Rowling. Funny. Yeah,
just getting
rowling. Tell us about her.
What, we're not going to spend the whole podcast talking about her, but I just want to say my thought on J.K. Rowling has always been, since this whole thing with her suddenly becoming a TERF of sorts, it's just like the Harry Potter series so much is about like people accepting others for who they are,
mm-hmm.
you know, like and kind of like playing up to their own strengths and being able to get through stuff together. Like, it always is full of such positive messages, and it's weird that this person would promote that sort of thing. But then there's that one sticking point, and that's where she gets stuck. Like everything else is fine, but you get stuck there. Like, you're that's the thing. It's like, at the end of the day, 90%ers like that disappoint me more than hardcore conservatives, because hardcore conservatives, fuck them. They believe whatever. They're stupid. They're ignorant. They believe what they believe. But people that believe, you know, in mostly good stuff, and then there's one really fucking stupid thing that they believe too. It's like, what is wrong with you?
And I think what makes me a little bit more upset, just in regards to the fact that J.K. Rowling is saying it too, is the fact that she tries to backpedal about it too, because she'll say things like, "Oh, I have nothing against trans people, but," and then she says her like shitty thoughts.
And then you repeat that like some bullshit fucking meme about like, "Oh, well, what if we let trans people go into bathrooms? They're gonna rape children." And as I've always said, if they could do that right now, they could go into a mall. So anybody could go into a mall and do that right now. Now, you may get arrested and you may spend the rest of your life in prison, but you could go do that right now. It doesn't matter what clothes you're wearing.
Also, everyone needs to fuck off with the I heart J.K. Rowling signs and shirts and pretending that it means anything but her real opinions on shit, because they we know what you're talking about.
Because again, I understand from the perspective of like what those books were going for and what people felt growing up and the positivity, in the same way that maybe a lot of us felt that way about Bill Cosby. And then, but at a certain point, the person, you can't stand up for the person. You can defend the art, but you can't defend the artist.
Listen, Kevin Spacey, fantastic appearance in the movie Seven. He's an
fantastic
absolute
actor across the board.
He's an absolute piece of shit, monster, rapist.
Chris Benoit, one of the finest wrestlers of all time and one of the greatest technicians that ever lived, and a fucking monster.
And a hell of a father.
And his child.
Yeah, like, exactly. You gotta separate it, folks. Gotta separate it.
Obviously, that's not, you can't totally do that. Like, that's the thing. It's like, I mean, it is very easy to say, oh, you could separate the art from the artist.
No,
and sometimes
that's easier
than others.
And I'm not jumping on that train either. People that say like, well, you got to just forget about it and just watch their movies and have a good time. It's like,
because if you know about the person, you will always inform their art by your knowledge of the person that made it. That's why I fucking love Firefly. And a lot of Joss Whedon movies, but I would find it very difficult these days to go back and watch that and see some of the things that he does, knowing the kind of shitbag he turned out to be, you know?
Well, and then you see things that make you go, oh, if I had known, this would make sense. So there you go.
A few moments. I feel like we had a few moments like that watching Mon Oncle Antoine.
Yes, we did. So there you go. We just want to get that out of the way a little bit. Also, apparently,
but
her initial design of the goblins who love money looked very borderline anti-Semitic.
Yeah, you can definitely read that into it.
She denies it, but
I did have that thought when I saw them for the first time, because they've got big noses and they love money. I mean, I don't know that they particularly love money. They just work with money.
Well, they're all the bankers, though.
Yeah, they're all, this society, this wizarding world has racially segregated professions, like being a fucking banker.
But there's no goblin.
No, you got to be a goblin.
There's no goblin bankers in this movie, Jason. This is Harry Potter.
Also, just to jump ahead to another movie, this is a world where slavery is cool because you can have a house elf. Now, we don't see Dobby in this movie, but eventually it's like, oh, yeah, you can just have a house slave. And they're cool with that in the wizarding world.
But they do also make a point in that movie of, like, Harry feels bad for him and tries to free him.
Yeah, and Hermione is politically active and starts her own, like, organization to liberate the elves.
Yeah.
But most of the, like, wizards just don't even give them a second thought, like slaves. Like, they just don't care. Well, it's like, oh, it's a house elf.
Jason, that's complacency. That's a real thing.
Like Dumbledore. Dumbledore's a good dude. I never saw him try to free a house elf, fucker.
All right, but we're not there to talk about house elves. We're not talking about the about.
We just need to establish the texture of this world of these weird quasi-fascist wizards.
Because
okay?
we don't have house elves in this movie. We don't have goblin bankers. We have Harry Potter and an Azkaban prisoner. We are going to get into this movie. Now, I want to ask you first of all, and I know we're going to give our opinions at the end.
Yeah.
But I'm just going to jump in and say, is this the best Harry Potter movie? I think it is.
Yes, I think it is. It's definitely my favorite book of the books, and they're all very good.
Mm-hmm.
But it is, it's definitely my favorite, especially because it was a dark departure.
Yes,
from the previous two books. Not that, I mean, the previous two books were fun and pretty light for the most part, and there was some scary stuff, but nothing major, right? But then this one goes down a dark path, and it's almost like the books were aging along with their audience, which is something that was neat about that series, is that as it went on, the books got longer and the plots got more complex and the characters got, you know, more interesting and kind of more mature. It's an interesting thing to read through, because like that first book is like, I don't know, 300 pages, if that. And by the time you get to the last book, Deathly Hallows, it's like 800 or 900 pages. It's almost a George R. R. Martin book. It's getting there.
Well, but published a lot quicker.
Oh, well, yeah. That give JK this. She got her done.
Yeah.
She fucking did it, boy. She got that fucking copy turned in.
But okay.
L. Ron Hubbard did it, babe.
Yeah, she started her own religion. Lord help us. Yeah, no, I would say this is the best one, too. And I think it's pretty much recognized, like, virtually across the board as the best one. And I think the difference between this one and all of the other ones is you don't have a director for hire here. Nothing against Chris Columbus, nothing against David Yates or the other directors that made the Harry Potter movies.
They do a great job.
You have Alfonso Cuaron, who is a guy who comes along, and he will never just be a director for hire. If he wants to make a movie, that is because it is his movie. It is something he wants to do, and he is always going to leave his stamp on it. It's like if you got Steven Spielberg to make a movie, he wouldn't just make a movie. He would make a Spielberg movie. Yeah. Alfonso Cuaron is going to make a Cuaron movie. Quentin Tarantino is going to make a Tarantino movie. Like, they had to know this going in to this project, and that if they're going to get Cuaron, they're going to get something different. And you really, you get that right away. Like you said, this movie is darker. This movie has more of an element of danger, I think. It's a little bit more tense than the other movies. Yeah. The other movies are very much kids' movies, I find. The previous two, anyway. I find this one, it starts to get more adult, like you said. Yeah. We start to get into more adult themes. We start to get to themes of, like, these characters growing up, not knowing who they truly are, identity issues. Like, it starts to really creep up.
And that darkness is reflected in the production design. If you notice, the first two Harry Potter movies, the Hogwarts has a very, like, public school feel. It's got manicured lawns. It's, you know, it's old, but it's like, it really feels like those type of public schools in Britain that, you know, rich people go to. In this movie, it has a much more aged feel. It's a much more like you see Hogwarts, it's like on a craggy rock, right? And it's much more like there are these, you know, hills that you go down, like Hagrid's house is down at the bottom of the rocks and everything. And it's just the whole movie just has a more, it feels older. It feels older and more natural, and like it's really part of this historic existence, you know, because Hogwarts has been there for a long time.
Yeah, it's,
but Cuaron does that very well, and this movie is it's a great looking movie.
But Jason, I'm even jumping ahead here. I forgot that we usually sum up the plot a little quick here. Yeah. So why don't you tell the folks, if they have never read or seen Prisoner of Azkaban, which is probably a minority of the audience listening to this, what is the plot of this one?
The plot of this one is that so Harry goes back to school, as he does every year after inflating his aunt in a fit of rage, because she was a real bitch. She was a real bitch, and we'll talk about her. But yeah, so he goes back to school that year, but it's kind of amongst a cloud because a deranged criminal named Sirius Black, who had been interned at the notorious Azkaban prison where very naughty wizards and witches are sent away and are managed by the Dementors.
Was that a Jeff Goldblum impression in the middle of that sentence?
Was it? I don't know.
Very naughty.
the
No, I just heard like very, very, very naughty. That just very sounded naughty. Very Goldblum-esque.
Very naughty. But yeah, naughty witches and wizards go there, and they're managed by the Dementors, which are these spirit-like creatures that can suck out your good feelings and leave only bad feelings. Mm-hmm. That's why you need cocaine, actually, to counter. They keep giving everybody chocolate to counter the Dementors. You need cocaine, because, as we learned, cocaine takes your bad feelings and turns them into good feelings.
Right, so, and she don't
that'd
lie.
Be actually a pipeline. That could be a pipeline to feed the Dementors. If you just kept doing cocaine, the Dementor could just keep sucking all those good feelings. You just keep doing cocaine.
But Jason, I've also heard that cocaine, she don't lie.
She don't lie.
Cocaine.
Early one morning while making the rounds, Brendan, I took a shot of cocaine and I shot my woman down. I went right home and I went to bed and I stuck a load of 44 beneath my head.
Well, that's so is that what happens in this movie?
No, what happens in this movie is that so because Sirius Black, this notorious criminal who is a murderer, who murdered Peter Pettigrew, a gentleman we get to learn who he is in a little bit, he went to prison, but he escaped somehow from Azkaban prison, and he's on the run. And so we have Hogwarts almost being turned into a bit of a police state school, with Dementors being there looking for this fucking guy because they think he's coming to the school, which they're right, because that's where he goes, babe. Of course, Harry, being Harry, is sticking his nose in shit that doesn't really concern him, although it does kind of concern him, because Sirius is looking for him. And he's told it's because he's got some vendetta against him because of his parents.
Right.
Yeah. But poor Harry, getting the sins of the father visited upon him. But, of course, we learn in the course of this that Sirius is not, in fact, a deranged criminal. He is a man who was wrongly put into Azkaban prison because he didn't actually murder anybody. He was fucked over by Peter Pettigrew, who disappeared, faked his death at that point, lopping off a finger and leaving it behind. Because they say he didn't just kill him, he destroyed him.
Mm-hmm.
But no, he spent many years undercover as a rat in the possession of the Weasley family, of course, Ron being the friend of Harry Potter.
Which, by the way, is one of the best reveals of any Harry Potter movie.
Yes, because that's been coming. That's the Scabbers has been in both the previous movies because it's Ron's rat. That's just his pet that he got from his brother.
Yeah, no, I love that because, I mean, being someone who's never read any of the books, I watched the first two movies, and like you said, I just assume, oh, yeah, that Ron has a rat. Cool. In this one, there's a constant back and forth between Ron and Hermione where Ron keeps saying, you know, keep your cat away from my rat. He's gonna eat him. He's gonna hurt him.
Yeah.
Clearly, the cat knows something is up. Like the cat is like
Crookshanks had something going on. He knew what was up.
Yeah, and but you don't read into that. What this movie's so good at is creating these little subplots that you don't think are important, but that part is incredibly important later on. It's not like the movie is even hinting at it whatsoever. Like it's just part of it. And if you read the books, obviously you know. So it's not a big deal if you already
know.
Well,
I don't. That's the thing. It's never. It's not like it's a thing that's foreshadowed throughout the first two books. It's just that Ron has a pet rat, and then it finally comes into play in Azkaban.
Yeah, but yeah. But all I'm saying is, like in the movie doesn't like. Oh, something's up with that rat. Like they don't. There's not even a slight hint made at that. So I think that reveal of the rat being, you know, Timothy Spall, Peter Pettigrew, is such a great moment. It's such a great build up and such a great moment, and it comes out of nowhere like an RKO. Yeah.
But and that's the thing about this series, Brendan, is that it does set it throughout its course. It seeds a lot of stuff that it does eventually pull back around, or something that figures into one movie then is available for future movies. Like the invisibility cloak is a good one. Like that's a major plot point in the first one, that Harry gets this invisibility cloak. But it continues to show up throughout the series because it's super fucking useful, and he doesn't just forget about it; he uses it. And that continues throughout the whole series, that these things and ideas pop up, the spells they learn, the experiences they have, it all kind of comes together, and I respect that. But anyways, the point is, the movie, so Sirius, of course, learns that, or we learn that Sirius isn't a bad guy. It turns out that he's Harry's godfather, actually, and that Peter framed him. Then we also have Professor Lupin, who is like in every movie, the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher, or was that it? Or was he Professor of Monstrology or something? No, he must have been the Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher. Yeah. So, but it turns out he is a werewolf, which is foreshadowed so wonderfully in that scene with the Boggart, where they're all facing their greatest fears, and he steps in front of Harry when Harry sees a Dementor, and it briefly shows the moon, which he then pops, and it kind of goes away. But yeah, it was a good bit. So by the end of the movie, of course, he's helped out Harry, and he's gone. He was a wolf, so he's going to resign and go elsewhere. But they managed to save the day. They save Buckbeak as well. I forgot to mention, actually, the end of the movie, the kind of resolution of the plot, it all turns on the time turner. Now, I need to ask Brendan, because I was watching this movie and it didn't. Did they explain why Hermione had the time turner?
She had the time turner because so they did a little running thing earlier, too, where Ron was like confused as to how Hermione was making it to all her classes at the seemingly okay. she just appeared. And yes, she had a bunch of classes scheduled at the same time, and she was using the time turner so that different versions of herself could attend every single class.
Okay.
Her by Dumbledore, I believe.
Yes. Yes. Okay. I'm good. Because for whatever reason, I didn't notice them actually explain that fact. And I knew that fact because I'd read the books as well as seen the movie before. But I wasn't sure if it actually was specifically explained.
It's explained very quickly, which is to the credit of the movie, is that they don't. That's another thing, too, man. This movie doesn't spend time just explaining shit to you. And I think I love that too. I think I love it. No. It reminds me of like when I watched the first Star Wars movie. There's so much shit they just talk about casually, and like I don't need to know everything.
You get it.
I don't need to know what Womp Rats are. You know what I mean? Like,
get it. It's like you bullseye with a T-16.
Yeah. Like you just say that I'm good. That's all I need. It's all about context clues. It's like I think that's the difference between good fantasy and bad fantasy. Is like. Yes. If you want to go back to Star Wars, the difference between the original movies and the prequels is that the prequels explain every goddamn thing. The first movie opens up with a 20-minute discussion about like Senate, whatever, like bullshit.
It's a lot of trade blockades and such.
Yeah. And like it's like we don't need that. It's like, and I think maybe the lesser Harry Potter movies, which I don't know, I think they're all like some level of good. But maybe like a lesser one, like maybe the next one or the one after that, maybe is a little more clunky when they're doing exposition. But this one is just like, you know, we have that opening scene of Mr. Weasley telling Harry about Sirius Black and about how he's going to come after him and blah, blah, blah. But it makes sense in the context of the movie. Of course, he's going to tell him about this and he's going to tell him all this information. This makes total sense. It's when we get like the opening narration. It's a voiceover. It's Harry talking to Hermione when both characters know about Sirius Black and him saying, Sirius Black is blah, blah, blah. Remember that? Oh,
Harry
I remember.
Harry Potter returns to school. Yeah. As Sirius Black escapes from Azkaban prison.
Or it's like Hermione saying, oh, remember when he did this? Oh, Harry's like, oh, I remember. And he said this. It's like, that's bullshit exposition to me. But this movie is just like the way it unfolds is natural and feels real.
The time turner, by the way, I wanted to mention that because the use of the time turner is done very well by the director, and he keeps track of everything in a good way. Because and the thing that stuck out to me was that, of course, watching this again, I know what's happens. I know that they save Buckbeak, right? They use the time turner and they save Buckbeak. But when we see that execution happen originally, it's in the distance, and we see him, we see the executioner like throw his axe down, and we assume that he's killed Buckbeak, but we don't see anything. And I think that's playing a little bit on my ideas, like, well, this is a children's movie. So they're not going to show a guy getting. So I assumed it was hidden, but no, we see that after the fact that they get Buckbeak out with the time turner, and then the executioner, because he's angry, just chops a pumpkin in half. And then that makes sense later on. We have the whole bit with like Harry standing by the window getting hit with the rock. Mm-hmm. And then later on we see them throwing the rocks. Like Like, there's no paradoxes or anything. It's like, it's just the stuff that they go back in time to do happens over the course of the movie as we're watching it, and then we eventually see them do it. Like,
yeah.
It's well constructed.
Yeah, that stuff, exactly. That stuff all happens before, that those little things, those little interference points happen before we get them actually using the time turner to go back and do those interference things.
Yeah, we see how they act, why those things happen. It's cool. I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, yeah, so the movie, everything resolves and everybody's happy, I guess.
Well, we'll get into it more as we go further. But when you have, like, a third Harry Potter movie, and you're three movies in, do you think people going to see this, maybe they haven't seen the first two, they're just going to see a Harry Potter movie, they're just going to see a movie. Do you think there's enough in this movie, or do you think there should be enough in a movie like that to bring people in a little bit?
Yes, 100%. Absolutely. Because that to me is the good franchise movie. A movie that can kind of quickly establish who our characters are without having to redo the origin story every single time. Because, yeah, sometimes new people just drop in. Like something like Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan did a lot better at the theaters than Star Trek the Motion Picture. So there were a lot of people that didn't watch that first movie that then watched that second movie. Now, obviously, those movies are not connected particularly story-wise, but then again, neither are most of these Harry Potter movies. Like, obviously there are things that happen that do carry consequences into forward, but each of the movies are kind of their own story, at least until you get to the last one, because it's part one and part two.
I would argue, like you said, there are things that they set up that pay off later, but certainly every one of these movies has its own self-contained plot.
Yeah.
And a beginning, middle, and ending.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing.
Exactly. It's... None of these movies are Two Towers, I guess, really, other than Harry Potter and Deathly Hallows Part 1, just because...
I would say Two Towers still has a beginning, middle, and ending.
Yeah, but it's the middle. It's the connective tissue of the trilogy.
Sure. But, I mean, I think a lot of movies, like, a lot of... There's a lot of examples where I can think of that they don't feel like a complete movie. Like, we're just setting up the next movie, and it's like... Why are we doing that? I think, honestly, and I know you don't watch a lot of these, but I think Marvel does a good job of this too, is that they'll have a movie certainly a movie to set up a character that is going to be important later, but that movie still has a beginning, it still has a middle, and it still has an ending. Yeah. It still has a conclusion. You might get a post-credit scene that is like teasing and what they're going to do, but the movie still ended.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Even Infinity War, where it was going to lead into Endgame, and we knew the next one was coming like 6 or 7 months down the road, that movie still ended.
And you could end a movie in a dark place or
Empire Strikes Back.
And still, yeah, exactly. Empire was going to be my thought. That's a great movie on its own. Theoretically, you could just watch Empire and kind of get what's going on.
You could.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Although,
to be fair,
I can't say for sure because I watched episode 4 first, obviously.
Yeah, because you're not a psychopath.
Not a crazy person, but there probably are people in this world that did see Empire Strikes Back for the first time, and I think that's a movie that works fine. But these Harry Potter movies definitely do. You get what's going on.
Yeah,
they're wizards.
Well, and maybe we'll kind of revisit this discussion though when we talk about eventually Deathly Hallows Part 2, because there's a different argument to be made there. But
for
now, yes, I agree. This is a self-contained movie. It's less of a direct sequel. I mean, it is a sequel. But it's just like another installment in the franchise.
See, and that's a counterpoint to a movie like the Downton Abbey movie, the one where the Queen comes to visit. Like, that's a movie that I don't think will mean anything to anybody that hasn't watched the TV series and is already familiar with those characters. Because, well, number one, there's a fuck ton of them. So they're not going to have time to set up everybody in the movie. But it's just like, I imagine somebody watching that movie is like me watching cricket. It's just like, what does anything mean?
Right. And I mean, you know what? If that's what you want to do, great. But I don't think that's particularly strong filmmaking.
No, it's basically a theatrically distributed episode of the TV series, which is fine. But
that's fine.
Not going to bring new people in.
Exactly. Like, that's fine. But, like, you know right away you watch that and you're like, oh, this is just for me because I watch the show. But you kind of wish sometimes, I don't know, I've seen movies like that too, and I kind of wish they would be a little bit more inviting for people who maybe never saw the source material or maybe the original TV show that it's based on. Like,
though, to be clear... The Downton Abbey movie, for those that are familiar with the TV series, is wonderful.
Well, there you go. If you've seen the show.
If you've seen the show, it is a wonderful experience.
Let's talk about a little bit about the cast in this movie. I mean, obviously, Daniel Radcliffe, mm-hmm. Rupert Grint, and Emma Watson are all back. I got to say, this is like Emma Watson's movie, man.
Yeah, she's great. Yeah, just, Hermione really is the brightest witch of her age.
She's the brightest witch of her age, and she's just got, like, I think she has the most to do, honestly.
Yeah, she is very much a driving character in this movie, driving the action forward.
Did you think, maybe this is just me being... overthinking. I'm going to put on my tiny film glasses. I haven't done Please that in do. A while, Jason.
Shove them in.
Shove them in?
Yeah, shove them into your eyeballs.
Oh, okay.
Because they're tiny.
Hold on.
Okay, there. You feel that pain? That's film pain. Use it.
All right.
You got this.
I thought that maybe some of the stuff around her was kind of metaphor for puberty, going through puberty, because she's right at the age, she's like, you know, 12-13.
This was Dumbledore says, who'd believe a bunch of 13-year-old wizards talking about something?
Yeah, and she, but she's like, they make reference to changes in her personality a little bit, like, yeah. Ron, I think this might be the first movie where Ron starts to kind of show a little bit of interest, yeah. In her in a more romantic way. They hint at it very small, but it's, you know,
we have that moment where Hermione is watching Harry and she kind of like goes and she grabs Ron's hand briefly and then kind of looks at him and then lets it go.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And she essentially figures out everything.
Yeah.
She saves the day. You know, these movies are called, you know, Harry Potter and, but this movie is, like I said, this is Hermione's movie. This is Emma Watson's thing. And it's easy to see why. I mean, certainly Daniel Radcliffe has done very well, and I like how he's kind of gone off and done a lot of weird stuff, too, to mm-hmm. just kind of differentiate himself as an actor. But Emma Watson really became the star from this franchise, and that's because she's just so charming, and she's just so good. I mean, she's just such a good performer, especially even at this age. Actress.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, well, all of them. Like, I mean, even that first movie, you know, they're all pretty young, and they're still. It's clear that they're still new to it and everything. They're still pretty darn good.
And not to slight Rupert Grint at all, but I'm just saying, like, objectively, out of the three, she is obviously the one that had became the biggest star.
I, of course, believe that Ron is my favorite because he also has red hair,
and he's not a villain.
He's not a villain. He's kind of dumb, but that's okay.
He is kind of dumb, and his family's poor. But
his family's poor, and he's dumb. But you know what? They're good. They're good salt of the earth people.
Good
Brendan.
People. At the end of the day, and I would say too, this movie has a little bit of like comments on class, right? Like a little bit, because we get the Weasleys, of course, Ron's family, and then the opposite end of that would be Draco Malfoy and his awful family. If this was,
they're all like they're basically wizarding royalty. They're the aristocrats whose names, you know, ring across the wizarding world.
Yeah, like if this was just about going to Hogwarts and this was like a coming of age movie. By the way, I kind of want to see that. He would be the main villain. Like Draco Malfoy would just be the villain.
Yeah, and more so than anything, he's a pain in the ass who eventually falls to villainy. That it's like it's almost like a tragic arc with him.
Is that where he ends up going? I don't remember.
Oh, he eventually like starts working for Voldemort, I think, by the end of it. Like he's involved with that. I know, I shouldn't have said his name.
Shouldn't have said his name, Jason.
It's a good thing. Voldemort is currently I said it again, shit. He who must not be named, Brendan, you know who, is currently laid up in Italy after a plane crash, so I think we're okay.
Wait, what?
This is Ray Fiennes? Is it Ray Fiennes or is it Joseph Fiennes? Wait, is it Joseph Fiennes? It's Joseph Fiennes, isn't it?
I think it is. I don't know. You look that up.
Hey, Siri. Who plays Voldemort? It is Ray Fiennes. My joke stands.
Well, we're clear with the joke police. Joke police are looking it over. They are all nodding. Looks good so far, Jason.
Giving thumbs up.
Hold on, Jason. Somebody's coming in right now. Oh, okay. No, he's throwing it out. Oh, appears that Jason is disqualified for horse tranquilizer in his system.
Look, that's nothing to do with the joke, man.
I'm sorry,
I wrote
Jason.
It when I was sober.
I'm very sorry, Jason. You've been disqualified for steroids.
Wait. Did you see steroids? I took horse tranquilizer, man.
The judges are looking again. They're nodding in agreement. Oh, now they're very angry.
Oh.
Jason, did you send them a nasty email before the show?
Can we just tell them to leave? I mean, it is our virtual space.
Well, I don't know. Can we? Let's see. The judges are looking at the
judges
the
are ruling. They're nodding. They're saying that yes, we can tell them to leave. So go. And there they go.
Oh, you
all get out of here. You can't be hanging out just judging people. That's not very Christian of you.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Oh, yeah, of course, fellas.
Yes, so the main three. Let's talk about, though, we get Robbie Coltrane back as Hagrid. A wonderful, warm performance, and someone I appreciate even more now, having watched him maybe not be so warm in some other movies. Jason, I know Richard Harris mentioned it, but I know you have some thoughts on this. Michael Gambon takes over the role here as Dumbledore. Yep. Now, he's not in a lot of this movie.
No.
I don't. Dumbledore is a pretty small background character in this movie. I think he probably ends up being more in the next one. But what do you think? What do you think of this performance?
I like Michael Gambon a lot. I think he's a great actor. He's obviously, I mean, he's been around forever. But God damn it, I thought Richard Harris was so perfect in that role that they cast him. Now, I'm obviously biased because I saw the movie first, so I understand that it's possible that it is just simply implanted in my brain that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he really embodied there's a certain gentleness to Dumbledore. There's a certain twinkle in his eye. And as time goes on, we do find out some deeper secrets about him and things that have happened in the past. But I really felt that Richard Harris had kind of embodied the idealized Dumbledore. And Michael Gambon is fine in that role, but he's much more, I don't know if I want to say aggressive, but he's much more bombastic. He's much louder. He's much more like giving a stage performance in a lot of ways. And that's fine. Again, I'll watch it all day. I don't mind. But for me, Richard Harris will and always be Dumbledore. And I'm thankful that we at least got two movies with him.
Well, and I mean, to the credit of Michael Gambon, and again, I've seen all of these movies once. It's hard for me to even compare, and that's why I asked you for your take, Jason. But I will say that to Michael Gambon's credit, he did make a point of not trying to copy Richard Harris's performance and to make it his own.
He definitely made it his own, and you got to respect that. If he just impersonated Richard Harris, what would that have been?
He did say that he put on a slight Irish accent, though, as like a little homage to Richard Harris.
That's very nice.
And what I said earlier at the top of the show is real. They did really offer this role to Ian McKellen. But Ian McKellen, first of all, he said, well, I played Gandalf. I think it's a little too similar.
Yeah.
And number two, he said it would be inappropriate because Harris had actually called McKellen a, quote, dreadful actor.
Really? Wow. <didn't>. What an asshole.
Yeah. I mean, Richard Harris, you know.
Richard Harris drank a lot, so I wonder if that was in his drinking days, perhaps, or if he just was like, oh, he's a dreadful fucking actor.
He did request that if he ever had to leave the role, Richard Harris did request Peter O'Toole. And the producers thought that was a bit of a dangerous thing. Because Peter O'Toole
even
was already...
Even in the 2000s? Was he still fucking drinking like a crazy man?
I mean, but he was very old, man. He was very old and his health was not so great.
He stayed alive for like... He could have done those movies. He was alive through Deathly Hallows, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
That would have been interesting. I wish I would have seen that. That would have been fascinating.
The other one that almost played Dumbledore, turned it down though, Christopher Lee.
Yep, I think he would have been a little darker Dumbledore just because he's Christopher Lee. It's hard for Christopher Lee to play good guys.
Yeah, and the only reason Christopher Lee didn't do it was for scheduling reasons. So, Jason,
Star
I think we were close to getting Christopher Lee as Dumbledore. Just saying.
Yeah, shame, shame, shame. Bloody shame.
And then talk about Gary Oldman, of course. Gary Oldman as Sirius Black. Great to see Gary Oldman. He said that this was actually one of the hardest roles he ever had to pull off. Because he said the difficulty with this role is that he said the dialogue. I mean, you have to say all these crazy things, right? All these like concepts and these fantastical words. And he said he compared it to basically trying to do like having to do Shakespearean dialogue, because it's hard to get a footing and make it all sound real and not forced, right? And
especially, I imagine Gary Oldman was not a guy who read through the Harry Potter series, so he wasn't necessarily familiar with it. So yeah, coming, it actually is reminiscent of on Star Trek when actors have to express what is known as technobabble, when they have to, we got to invert the polarity of the deflector shields, and if doing so, we can cause a neutrino emission to backfire across the sector, like that sort of shit, and making it sound realistic, even though it just sounds like, just a mess to anybody who's not in that. You know?
And making it sound like you know what you're saying.
Exactly. What you're saying is natural, and you're saying it, you mean it, you understand it.
And I will tell you, Jason, he accepted the part because he needed the money. He's very open about that. He said he hadn't taken any major work in quite a few years because he was spending more time with his kids at the time. And when the offer came in, he took it because he just needed the cash.
Well, I mean, he puts in a great performance because that's the thing about Gary Oldman, too, is that even though I know Gary Oldman's in this movie, whenever I see Gary Oldman in a movie, it doesn't click to me that it's Gary Oldman. Like when I was watching this movie, I was thinking about all the cast, right, and all the different actors. But Gary Oldman didn't enter into my head until much later. I was like, oh, yeah, right. Gary Oldman is in this movie. Of course he is. He's just such a chameleon.
Yeah. No, he really is. The only time I really, really notice him is like Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy because it looks like him.
Yeah, and he's the main character in that movie. That's the thing. For a long time, Gary Oldman was not the main character in a movie.
Right. Wonderful to see returning David Thewlis as Mr. Mm-hmm. Professor Lupin. Another fun character because this is a guy, you know, he turns out the twist with him is he's a werewolf. And there's so many references to it. I mean, his name is Remus Lupin.
Yeah.
It's right there in his name. But I mean, if you've never read the books, like I didn't read the books, I don't know what that is. I'm just like, okay, his name is Remus Lupin. Cool. And then when
he's a werewolf, if you were familiar with like kind of traditional, mythology, as it were, around werewolves, you would know Lupin is like a Latinized, it's related to the werewolf concept. But
sure,
but I didn't think about that the first time I saw it.
But I'm just saying, like, I wouldn't just assume that he would later become a werewolf. Like, no. When it's revealed, you think back to the name and everything. But, again, it's a reveal that's not super in your face.
And that's understandable because in 2004, Brendan, for werewolves, you were focused, I'm sure, on Underworld. Did that come out that year? I think it came out that year.
I was more into the lichens. And I just was like, there's no way he's a werewolf because where's Kate Beckinsale to fall in love with him? Alan Rickman, of course, showing up as Severus Snape, maybe the best casting in this entire movie, in this entire franchise, I think.
One of the most natural choices, just like, of course he would play that role. I mean, there's no argument with that. He's fantastic as always, and we'll get that voice. Mr. Potter.
Sadly, of course, Timothy Spall is also perfectly cast because this is the only characters he gets to play for the most part, this rat-faced Peter Pettigrew kind of character. Yeah.
And he's great. He's fantastic. And he speaks well with those fucking teeth in his mouth.
Jason, I love seeing our old friend Emma Thompson showing up.
Mm-hmm. And Trelawney.
Yeah, she's not afraid to just ugly it up. She's not afraid to get deep into character. She's not afraid that she's not one of those actors who like, I have to look good all the time while I'm doing this movie. Like she's playing a weirdo.
She plays a character. She's right deep into the character. What I really like about her, and you only see a little bit of this in the movie, I feel like there's more in the book about it, but Hermione doesn't really respect Professor Trelawney because she's a professor of divination. And I think Hermione is very much of like the logical scientific approach to wizarding and magic, which is funny. But like, she's like, no, this is bullshit. She's just new age bullshit. And she doesn't take her seriously, even though she's taking the class because she's that kind of like go getting student. It's like, yeah, I need the class. I'll take the class, but I don't necessarily agree with it. It's like a creationist taking biology.
I'll take it for the fucking credit.
Yeah, exactly.
And then Kevin Sorbo walks in the room and he's like, I want you to write God is dead on a piece of paper.
If you write God is dead on this piece of paper, class dismissed for the rest of the term. How do you like that?
A plot of a real movie, folks. Yeah, so I mean, it's wonderful to just see all these people, and they're all having a good time. I think that's the best part of it. I mean, and they're all showing up in like very briefly. Like Maggie Smith is barely in this movie, but she's there, and it's always fun to see her.
Yep.
And
like a character like McGonagall doesn't necessarily have to be in every scene in the movie because she plays bigger parts in different movies. But the fact she's there, she's one of the continuing, like Dumbledore and Snape. They're like, you know, they're the faculty. You see them, even if you don't see them all the time, you're going to see them at some point. And that's part of the texture of the universe.
Yeah, and like Snape is not in this one particularly a whole lot either. Like this is mainly
he gets to be a dick. He gets to be a dick like he always does. And he does. Our famous Snape,
but he really doesn't show up in a lot of the movie. But it's because it's mostly Potter, Ron, Hermione especially, Hagrid has quite a bit to do in this one, and obviously Sirius Black and Professor Lupin. Those are the main people we get in this movie, for the most part.
For sure.
Can we talk about the special effects in this movie and how they don't look like a big CGI glop?
No, the gap between 2001 and 2004 is quite vast, it seems. Because if we go back to that first Harry Potter movie, that troll early on is rough. There's all, and the you see Harry bouncing around in the back of it, and it's clearly a CG doll. Like, it's just, doesn't look great. Doesn't hold up very well.
Do you think it's because this one's darker and they're able to hide a few more flaws, or do you think it's because?
I think it's a combination of both. Then the technology just getting better. It's still not, you know, to what we would expect today, but you can definitely see the huge improvement the 3 years made.
Yeah, well, I just find the way they utilize them to be more clever. Like, I think it's easier to do. I would say easier, but I think it always looks better, these effects that just show things like floating or flying through the air, because you can hide things, you know, you can hide things like strings and pulleys and whatever.
And I think Cuaron, being such a filmmaker that loves dark stuff, right, loves doing stuff at night and loves having, I mean, that's not what he always does, because Itumama Tamien is very much in the daytime a lot.
But that didn't have a whole lot of CGI.
No, but yeah, in this movie, like that fight between Lupin and Sirius takes place at night between the werewolf and Sirius in dog form, because of course Sirius is an animagus and can turn into a dog. But yeah, they do it at night, so it covers up some of the bullshit of it, and it looks fine. Looks fine. It's not great, but it's better than it could have been.
By the way, when describing a Harry Potter movie can you brush off quickly the fact that Gary Oldman plays a character that can turn into a dog. By the way, anyway, whatever.
At will, whereas Lupin is werewolf, and he turns into a werewolf when the moon is out.
Yeah.
And he forgot to take his medicine, I guess.
Forgot to take his medicine. I love, by the way, the moment where they're all going to they're all in class, and they're going to that, like, I guess it's like the fear closet.
Yeah. Oh, and they're doing there's a boggart in the closet.
Yeah, they're all seeing... They're all
monster that embodies your fear.
Right. They're all seeing, like, their worst fear. So, of course, Ron is seeing, like, a giant spider. Harry sees what does Harry see? Does he see
Harry sees a Dementor.
Dementor, right.
Because we have like Neville, who's scared of Snape, and so he sees Snape, and then he pictures Snape in his grandmother's clothes, and that's fun. That Alan Rickman got to put on a dress that day.
Yeah, and the nice little hint in that scene is that very quickly when Lupin gets in the way, when the Dementor actually seems like it's gonna hurt Harry and he gets in the way, there's a full moon in his.
Hmm. Yes, exactly. Why would a man be scared of a moon?
It's like, oh, okay. But you don't really look at, but again, it's not something you give it a second thought, because you're like, oh, well, Harry just saw a Dementor. Maybe the moon is out when that Dementor's out there.
You know what would really, what if Buzz Aldrin stepped in front of that boggart and we saw the moon? What would that tell us? That's a scary thought.
I think he would see Neil Armstrong.
He's scared of Neil? Is that why he let him go down the stairs first?
That's right. He's you try it.
Only man I'm scared of is Neil Armstrong. You don't want to piss that boy off. I don't know why I'm making Buzz Southern. I don't think he
is. My name's Buzz Aldrin, and one time somebody asked me if the moon landing was fake, and I punched him in the face.
That's why they didn't let Buzz go down first, because he would have been like, holy shit, I'm on the fucking moon.
Can you imagine if that was the first phrase?
First words of playing that in every classroom across the country. Holy shit, I'm on the fucking moon.
Buzz, what you want to explain what your thoughts are right now?
Well, shit, man, I'm walking around this fucking, it's a different planet, y'all. I'm walking, you're on that fucking planet, I'm on this fucking planet, we're on different fucking planets, but I'm still talking to y'all. I'm Buzz Aldrin. Beep.
Buzz, it's not a planet, it's a moon. Beep.
Oh, shit, that's why I didn't pass astronaut school. Wait, what, you didn't?
How did you sneak onto the flight, Buzz?
Well, I'll tell you something. I'm getting more silent by the minute. But the old Buzzy Aldrin, Buzzer, as they used to call me back in high school, I done flunked out of every class I ever taken. And here I am on the moon. Shit.
And scene.
Buzz Aldrin.
Harry Potter.
So any other big things you want to talk about, Jason, before we... read some bits and possibly Bob's.
I'm scouring my brain, Brendan, and I'm trying to think if I missed something, but I guess we'll find it in the bits and Bob's.
All right, well, let's do it. Let's take a break. We'll listen to some ads, some sponsors, and then we will be right back with some bits and Bob's.
Age of Radio. Age of Radio.
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
I fought the bits and the bobs won. I fought the bobs and the bits won. So I didn't fight no one anymore, 'cause bits and bobs won. So instead I looked at Jason and I said, "Jason, bits and bobs. Jason, why don't you get your bits and bobs, bits and bobs, bring your bits and bobs, put them on the fucking table and tell me your bits and bobs. Make sure you tell me all about your bits and your bobs, bits and bobs, and Jason and Brendan."
So if you'll remember, Brendan, in Itu Mama Tambien, one of the more memorable scenes in that movie.
I've never seen it.
Oh, you should. It's a great movie. But it's about two fellas who, two young gentlemen who go on a road trip and fuck a MILF over the course of it. It's a good time.
Spoiler
but there is
alert.
A scene where these two gentlemen, who are best friends, decide they go out to a pool which has two diving boards, and they both proceed to masturbate on the diving boards.
Does that happen in this movie?
No, it does not. Oh. But I feel like the very first scene of this movie is a bit of a maybe perhaps a masturbation metaphor, where Harry is under the covers attempting to what is he doing, the knock spell? He's trying to do the light spell, and then he would like, and then Dursley would come to his room and he'd like pretend to be asleep and he'd come in and look around and then leave, and then Harry would do it again and then come back. Maybe I'm reading too much into it, but I think that's a masturbation metaphor.
Well, I mean, it ties into the whole thing with Hermione and possibly a puberty metaphor, so maybe it's applying for all of them.
Again, we talked about the idea of like a movie introducing characters without having to fully explain who they are. This movie is great because right off the bat, even if you've never seen Harry Potter, you get the sense that the Dursleys are pieces of shit. And mm-hmm. you should, because they are. They treat Harry like shit. They always have. They kind of got stuck with him after Harry's parents died. And they blame him for a lot of bullshit. And then they invite Vernon Dursley, Richard Griffith's sister, Margaret, over. And she's just as shitty as the rest of them. And one of the things she says I thought was interesting in foreshadowing, where she said, she was talking about Harry, and she says, "This is all to do with bad blood," which mm-hmm. is foreshadowing the idea of the mud blood and the idea that people who aren't pure blood wizards are not worthy of being wizards.
That's a little bit of a little bit of racism shit.
Yeah,
there.
No, absolutely, for sure.
Is Hermione not also supposed to be like not fully wizard?
She is referred to as a mudblood. I believe she is the... So there's a person in the wizarding world called a squib. That is a person who is born from two wizards who has no magical powers, right?
Okay.
She's the opposite. She is a wizard. She has magical powers, but she comes from two parents who do not have any magical powers.
Ah.
Yes. So she is looked down upon, or it's usually that she's called a mudblood, much like, or if a wizard is in a relationship with a person who's not a wizard, their children would also be considered mudbloods.
Yeah.
In this racist hierarchy.
Guys, our main point here is that wizards fuck.
Wizards absolutely fuck. Wizards also, back in the day, a new fact we learned in recent years was that they would take a shit before toilets. They would just shit on like the floor, and then they would apparate their shit away somewhere. Now, JK never pointed out where the shit went, but I'd like to think that there's just a place in the world where there's just a massive mountain of wizard shit from like the thousands of years.
Indoor plumbing was invented. I'd like to hope it's somewhere in Mar-a-Lago.
Yeah, it's right in the middle of Florida.
Yeah.
Let's see what else we got here.
Horror elements start creeping their way in, Jason.
Yeah, well, Harry gets mad because Margaret's being such a total bitch to him. And actually says to him at one point, he's talking about his mother, he says, if there's something wrong with the bitch, then there's something wrong with the pup. Which is, ouch! And that really sets Harry off, because you do not talk about Harry's mother. And he caused her to expand and float away. She basically turned into a big balloon and floated away. And that's a no-no. That's a no-no. In the wizarding world, most people, if you do that shit, that's a problem. You're an underage wizard. You can't be... And this is why I love... This is one of the reasons why I love this universe, is because there are very clear rules. Like, it's like any good science fiction or fantasy. You have clear rules from the outset, and you work within those, right?
Yeah.
And there's an entire government ministry dedicated to dealing with wizards. And this is one of the rules. If you're an underage wizard, you don't do magic outside of school, because it can draw unwanted attention. And she ends up floating across the whole fucking neighborhood. So that's probably a lot of work for the wizard police to clean up.
And that's also, let's not forget, too, it's also a thing where... because he doesn't end up getting in trouble, you're kind of like, oh, okay. So something's off here from the get-go. Like something is askew right away.
Well, also, by this point, we know that Harry Potter is a prominent character in this world. Like, not necessarily of his own doing, but because of his encounter with Voldemort, the death of his parents, the scar he has. Like, he is a known person. And regardless of whether he wants to be dragged into stuff or not, he will get dragged into stuff. And so...
Right.
The stuff that happens with him is, I guess, of interest to the wizarding world. He shows up, of course, in the papers, and we see that with that reporter from later movies that comes after him.
I do like, I think that this movie does an incredible job of, like, just the placement of everyone. Because, like, there's so many scenes where, like, we have those great newspapers that have, like, you know, motion.
Animated
in them.
GIFs,
they're
yeah.
Animated, like... Not anime, but you know what I'm saying. Like the newspapers,
no, they're basically
images.
GIFs in a newspaper. But yes,
yeah, exactly. They are GIFs in a newspaper, 100%. But it's cool because you have that going on. You have characters having a conversation. That scene where Ron's father, Mr. Weasley, is talking to Harry, and they're walking around, and they get to that area to have that discussion. That staging of that is crazy. It seems like such a simple thing, but you watch that and you're like, holy shit, there's like a visual effect going on here. There's people in the background here. The conversation's happening here. These people need to be in these certain spots at all times. Like it's something that, like, you know, it's visually impressive, and it's even more impressive when you think about the mechanics of it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, this movie is very well constructed. Ultimately, we can say that without.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about that fast bus with the chandelier?
The Knight's bus. Yes, the Knight's bus, which I guess picks up wizards that are having issues, and they realize Harry's there, so they pick him up. That is a great sequence, the sequence of the bus just driving at super fast speeds through the city and avoiding all the cars. And now it's, of course, invisible to everybody else, but Harry's on the bus and having the ride of his life.
But isn't it such a great detail, though, that they have a chandelier in the bus?
They have a chandelier, and they also have a shrunken head that speaks with a Jamaican accent, which I thought,
that's
2004 awesome. Right there.
yeah.
But that is a really fun sequence. And so Harry is taken to the Leaky Cauldron, which is a pub that he's been to before. That's run by Julie Christie's character. And he gets a room there for the night. And I loved it. It was like he got Elwood Blues' room because it's right next to the train.
Yeah. Harry Potter's got 60 miles to Chicago and half a pack of cigarettes.
Yep. Oh. Absolutely. Hogwarts sort of becomes a police state in this movie with the Dementors. Like, I wonder if there's a little bit of comment maybe on the Bush era through this. It's not super deep or anything, but the fact that they're having to, like, lock the school down and bringing these Dementors to keep an eye on everything. And
2004.
And it's sort of representative of the dark pact that is having state-enforced violence to maintain order, you know?
There's a quote that I... Oh, sorry. No, continue.
I would say using these characters that are clearly, like, pretty malevolent beings, but somehow maintaining control of them and using them for your own purposes.
One sec. There's a quote that pops up around this time that I really like when someone says, Happiness is found in the darkest of times if one remembers to turn on the light. Hmm.
That's more foreshadowing.
Yeah.
Because we see how when David Thewlis, when Professor Lupin initially deals with that Dementor, he pulls out his wand and hits them with what is essentially what looks like a bolt of light. Later on, we learn that he's going to teach Harry how to make his Patronus, which is a manifestation of your kind of emotions that can help deal with something like a Dementor. Foreshadowing that the light is important.
Exactly.
What else we got here, Brendan? I said I had that turn on the light. Yeah.
I like sorry.
What?
Go.
A scene I really like because it rings true is there's a scene very much of boys being boys where Ron and Harry and I think Dean is his name and maybe another guy are hanging out in the room and they're eating those like beans that are allowing them to make animal noises.
Mm.
And it's just a bunch of teenagers, like 13-year-old boys fucking around in a room. And that was one of the most grounded moments in the movie to me is because even though I didn't do that thing because it doesn't exist, I had moments like that definitely growing up.
Well, that's another strong part of this movie, Jason, is that there's all these fantastical things happening, but ultimately at the end of the day, it's all linking to relatable kind of situations. Like boys will be boys, like you said, just boys hanging out being dudes, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like ultimately it's about camaraderie, it's about friendship, it's about this, it's about that. Class struggle, being a female in a boy's world, it's very much that's another thing that separates this from bad fantasy or bad sci-fi is that they tie it into things that people can relate to. If it's just a bunch of gibberish, I don't care. Like, ultimately, I don't care how cool everything looks. Listen, pod race scene in Phantom Menace, great. It's like 38 hours long, and I didn't care once while watching it. I don't care how nice it looked. I did not give a shit.
It's one of those scenes that on its own, it's a fantastic short film. But in the movie, it's just like, okay.
Yeah, it's like, okay, is this going to be over soon? But like, because this movie is so good at that, you're able to connect with these characters. And even it's the third movie, but you're really able, I think, for the first time, really connect with these characters in this movie.
But again, that I think that's the advantage of the Wizarding World, that it's this weird sort of parallel existence to the real world that is unaware of it. These characters do ultimately have the same problems that we all have. But it's then couched in magic.
Yeah. We didn't talk about why Buckbeak was being executed and that there's
was being executed because Draco Malfoy is a shit.
So Harry Potter goes over to, Buckbeak and he's like doing his little curtsy, he's bowing and he gains Buckbeak's trust. And then, of course, Draco Malfoy comes over and he's a little piece of shit and he starts like fucking with him and Buckbeak is about to take him out and Hagrid has to like back him off. And then of course Draco Malfoy's dad is like Lucius and he's rich and he pushes the committee to essentially have Buckbeak executed for attacking his son.
Yes, his poor boy.
It's like when somebody antagonizes a dog and they get bit and then they try to have the dog put down. It's like, no, fuck you.
Fuck you. You were the one that caused it. Anybody would do, any dog would do that in that situation, no matter how nice they were, if you fuck with them. Same with Buckbeak. But also Buckbeak is very much because he bows to him because Buckbeak demands respect. Because he's very proud. He's very proud hippogriff. Hippogriff? Did not hippogriff.
And I think the moment where you...
Is he hippogriff?
Hippogriff, that's what they said.
Okay.
I think the moment where you see the axe come down and you think that he's executed, that's the darkest moment in Harry Potter up to this point.
Yeah.
In any Harry Potter movie up to this point. I mean, I know it gets darker later on down the line, but I think at this movie, that is like the first moment where people are like, oh, shit.
Yeah, fuck. Good old Buckbeak, man. He's cool. I would like to ride around on Buckbeak if he would let me, if I would respect him. Time Turner. I want to talk about the Time Turner again, just to say that anytime there's time travel involved, like there's a lot of items in these movies that because of the magic aspect are just like they're problem solving things. And they are very conveniently useful. And the Time Turner's one. The Invisibility Cloak's another. There's probably others. It's been a while. But I love time travel. Happy to see it. And they made it work well.
And they made it work well, especially because, like you mentioned earlier, because they do that thing where they set up the little interruptions before we see how they happened.
Everything works and pays off.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Percy. Percy's a knob. Percy is Ron's older brother, one of Ron's older brothers. Ron's got, like, so many siblings. But Percy's, like, the head boy, And you only hear him in one scene where he's just like, it's after the fat lady disappears from her painting. And you could just hear him in the background being like, line up, everybody. I'm the head boy. Blah, blah, blah. And fuck you, Percy. You prick. That's what I'm saying. Percy's a prick. Now, Bill's cool. Bill's Percy's older brother who like is the archaeologist. They go to Egypt and they mentioned going to Egypt in the movie. I assume it was because Bill was there on a dig.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, by the way, okay, so that Quidditch in the rain scene is fucking cool. I always enjoy the Quidditch scenes in this movie, and this isn't a big one, like especially compared to like the first movie where they really, you know.
Well, because we don't need a big one, right? We've already seen a full game, so
yeah,
we don't need to watch like a full thing of Quidditch.
But it's cool that having it in the storm. It's like when you see football in the rain or in the snow and it's muddy. It adds to the whole aspect of it. And of course, we have the whole bit where he falls from the sky and his broom gets fucked up. But just so cool. Such a great sequence. At one point in the movie, Harry's in a room and there are candles made from human spines in the background. I thought that's dark.
Yeah.
That's fucking dark, guys. Like, where did those come from? Where did you get those?
I enjoy the moment where Dumbledore says, I'll have a cup of tea or a large brandy.
And then at one point Hagrid says, there's there's only large glasses in my house or something like that.
Yeah. But I like how it's like, I'll either calm down with a nice cup of tea or drink a ton of alcohol.
I do like Michael Gambon in some moments, and that is one of those moments. He just delivers that line very well. There's a lot more casual dress in this movie. In the previous movies, and you see it in this movie, but they're very much in their school uniforms most of the time, which makes sense. They're at school. But a lot of this is taking place outside of actual class time. So we see them just in their own casual clothes for a lot of the movie. And that's cool, too. Because especially us here in the Americas, we're not really linked to that. We don't relate to the school uniform because most schools over here don't have them. Whereas they're like almost like public or private. They all have uniforms over in Britain.
And I've got a little bit on that too when we're through this here.
Nice. When she punches Draco, that's a wonderful scene.
Hermione.
Hermione, absolutely. She just fucking slams into him. She's got a fucking wand to his neck. Number one, she's like, I do it, and then she walks away, and he's like, oh, and so she turns around and just fucking whacks him and sends him off whining to daddy. Another line I like, Brendan, is when Sirius Black is talking about the fact that he transforms into a dog and about how he was kind of got into a fight or whatever. And he's just like, I usually have a rather sweet disposition as a dog. I just like that line. I just think that's great.
I've got a question. This is my last bit and Bob. This is just my last note about it.
Oh, I hope it's my question, but we'll see.
Well, I don't know. No, probably not. But I'm going to ask it anyway, Jason. We've got all these legendary people, legendary British actors of stage and screen.
Mm-hmm.
Where's Michael Caine?
That's a good question. Michael Caine should have been in these movies somewhere.
Imagine Michael Caine as Dumbledore.
What was all never in Harry Potter movies? You're a wizard, Harry. He'd sound like fucking, they could have got him to play Hagrid. He could have done that.
What do we do when we fall down, Harry Potter? We get back up.
Good night, you princes of Hogwarts. You kings of Maine.
It's time for me to get Carter. What? Nothing.
Don't worry about it. Okay, here's my question, which was not that. My question, and this is very important. So
why is Mike Myers not in this? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
So when we first see Peter Pettigrew transform, also an animagus, because he can transform into a rat, transforms from a rat to a human, we see him, and he's like wearing a suit. Later in the movie, he transforms back into a rat, but he transforms and the suit is left.
Mm.
So does he transform with his suit initially? And so that when he does it the next time, he loses the suit and then he's just going to be naked.
So I think ultimately what you're saying, Jason, is that you wanted more accuracy and you wanted to see a buck naked Timothy Spall.
Yes. 100%. If you're going to do it right. And wouldn't it be great if the first, G-rated movie with a penis in it was, Timothy Spall's.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it. Let's make it happen. And that's it, really. I mean, the only last thing was, did they explain why she had the time turner? They did. Dumbledore gave it to her because he's a good dude, and he wanted her to, go to all the classes she wanted to go to. Although I think it is ultimately a bit naive to trust a teenager with a time machine, even if it is Hermione. Hermione is probably the one you would trust with it, but still.
Yeah.
That's tempting. That's tempting to fix things,
Sure.
But clearly I think, she got through it.
very trustworthy character, though, I think. I wanted to mention first, because I want to mention before I forget, is that you said a lot of them are, they're not really in their uniforms that much. And they are sometimes, but a lot of times they're wearing their casual clothing.
And that's the thing, too. Even when they are wearing their uniforms, it's often like they've got their coats open or they've got them off. They got the tie undone. They're rumpled.
So what Cuaron did is he actually went to all the kids in the movie and told them to wear their uniforms as they would if their parents weren't around. That's nice. What he told. That was his direction to them. So, and he even consulted Rowling on it, and he said, it makes no sense for them to be wearing their uniforms all the time. They did it in the first two films, and that's great because we're just establishing them. And he said, but I want to give them more individuality with their clothing. I want them to kind of stand out a bit more and have each one of them look different from the other. So that's why he does that. I mean, obviously, when they're in class, they're a little more prim and proper. But a lot of times, they're kind of like you said, they're wearing the uniforms, kind of whatever. Yeah. I think Hermione's is probably very good, well mannered and everything, because that's Hermione's character. But Ron's gonna have it half off and stuff.
Oh yeah, shirt untucked, tie loosened. Yeah, he doesn't give a fuck. Ron's just a good old boy.
My favorite character description that Alfonso Cuaron had is he said for Lupin, he wanted him to look like a quote, an uncle who parties hard on the weekend.
He does, because he got all those various injuries from his werewolf romps.
Well, because he has the tweeds, tweed kind of look of England, but then he also it looks a little more unkempt, right? A little more shabby. Emma Thompson actually made sketches herself of what the costume could look like for her character, and she said that she saw her character as a person who hasn't looked in the mirror for a long time. And then what they did is to highlight kind of her she's short-sighted, so they used this material filled with mirror and eyes and an oversized glasses with magnifying lenses. He wanted Dumbledore to look like an old hippie, but still very chic.
Yeah, I like that. With the Captain Lou Albano thing in his beard.
Yeah, and he even gave him a little tie-dyed silk that would kind of float behind him while walking. A difference from the kind of majestic look that Richard Harris had as Dumbledore.
Harris definitely had classical fantasy mage kind of look to him. Whereas Gambon's Dumbledore is a little more earthy, a little more to the ground.
So this with this movie, they actually switched to a longer cycle to make these movies. So before, I don't know if they were doing, I think they were doing a 10-month or 12-month cycle. But with this movie, they switched to an 18-month cycle.
Yeah, because the first movie was 01, the second movie I think was 02, and this was 04.
Yeah, so this is where they started to get we need to start putting more time into these movies because they're getting more intricate, we're getting more characters, we need to put the work in, we can't just slapdash this together. Jason, I want to tell you, they almost got some of the, I don't know if you know this already, but some of these directors that almost did this movie might blow your mind. So the first one they almost got was Guillermo del Toro.
That'd be fun.
he said he was put off by the first two movies. He said they were too bright and happy and full of light.
Did he say, look, I would do this movie. Oh, he's not French. I would do this movie, but these cocksuckers, I don't like Harry Potter. This is the worst of Guillermo del Toro ever. I wish I could do a good him.
He's a very nice man. I doubt he said that.
No, he loves the word cocksucker. I've heard him say it quite a bit. He says cocksucker.
But he did not do it. Mark Forster actually turned down the movie because he had just made Finding Neverland and he was like, I don't want to direct child actors ever again.
Ah, wow.
So do with that what you will. Kenneth Branagh, who actually was in Chamber of Secrets as Gilderoy Lockhart.
Great character.
Turned it down. He said, no, thank you. But here's the name that almost directed this movie, Jason, and only turned it down because he was working on his own film, and that director would be Mr. M. Night Shyamalan.
Ooh.
He was interesting. He turned it down because he was making The Village.
Okay. All right.
What would have been the twist in this Harry Potter movie? Oh, wait, shit. This movie did have a twist, so he would have right at home.
The Sirius wasn't the bad guy. Yeah, he could have had fun with that.
He would have been right at home. But yeah, M. Night Shyamalan was like, nope, got to make The Village. People are going to love it.
People want to see The Village, so I need to do that.
And even when Cuaron came on, he basically said, I haven't read any of the books. I haven't seen the movies. And Guillermo del Toro had apparently been like, oh, don't be arrogant. Read the books.
Yeah. don't be an asshole.
Because, yeah, he said, like, I don't read the books. I haven't seen the movies. I don't know if I want to do it. And then as soon as Del Toro got him to read the books, he was like, I'm in. Let's do it.
Nice.
He also, another fun thing he did was he got each actor, so each main actor, he got Daniel Radcliffe, Rupert Grint, Emma Watson to write an autobiographical essay about their characters written in the first person from birth to the discovery of basically Hogwarts and this like magical world.
What an asshole, giving his fucking child actors homework?
I think it's a great idea.
I mean, yes, it is, but...
So here's the thing. Emma's essay was like 10 pages long. Daniel's was 2, and Rupert didn't do one. And he said perfect. To Rupert, he said, well, why didn't you do it? And he said, I'm Ron. Ron wouldn't do it. He said, then Cuaron said, oh, so you do understand your character.
That's fantastic. I love that.
Yeah, so that's an interesting way he kind of came on and did that. And yeah, just the only other thing I have really is that they used a lot of real locations, and that kind of helps this. That kind of helps give this a different look than the other movies.
Yeah, absolutely, it really sells it.
Jason, this does go to the Oscars. Nominated for 2 Oscars. Can you tell me what Oscars it gets nominated for?
Best costumes and best cinematography.
No, oh. It gets nominated for best original score.
Okay.
Which goes to Finding Neverland. Which is funny, Mark Forster. And best visual effects, which goes to Spider-Man 2.
Yeah, I mean, at the time, I would say Spider-Man 2 was kind of a high watermark. It looks so much better than the first one.
Does go to the BAFTAs. Is nominated for 4 awards. Does not win anything, but it is nominated for 4. It is nominated for best production design, which goes to The Aviator. Mm-hmm. It is nominated for best makeup and hair, which goes to The Aviator. Mm-hmm. Is nominated for Best British Film, which goes to My Summer of Love, of course.
Okay, yeah. Sure.
And this is the most baffling one, though, Jason, and we have to maybe talk about how stupid this is. It's nominated for Best Visual Effects, which I completely agree with, and the winner is The Day After Tomorrow.
Huh.
Like, really? Really? Over this?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe that more impressive in 2004?
No, that's ludicrous. There's like CGI wolves in that movie that look terrible.
Well, maybe because there was a lot of effects in that movie. There was just so many. They just went on sheer quantity.
Yeah. But of course, we know the reviews of this movie were pretty much universally positive. It has a 90% on Rotten Tomatoes. The consensus is under the assured direction of Alfonso Cuaron, Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban triumphantly strikes a delicate balance between technical wizardry and complex storytelling. Mick LaSalle of the San Francisco Chronicle said it was darker, more complex, rooted in character. The Hollywood Reporter said it was a deeper, darker, visually arresting and more emotionally satisfying adaptation of the J.K. Rowling literary phenomenon. Roger Ebert said that the film was not quite as good as the first two, which is, I think, crazy, but, you know, whatever. He gave it 3.5 out of 4, but he said it was delightful, amusing, and sophisticated. USA Today said a visual delight and said that Cuaron is not afraid to make a darker film and tackle painful emotions, while Richard Roper said the movie was a creative triumph. I'm trying to see if there's anything negative, but not really. BBC, there was a review from the BBC that said the sets and the direction were really nice, but did not find the movie emotionally engrossing. And that's pretty much the closest I have to a full-on negative review. I'm sure Armand White hated it, but I don't have his snippet of a review. The budget for this movie was $130 million.
Oh, damn.
And
that's a lot of money in 2004.
And it cleared $797.5 million.
Sounds about right.
So, Jason, we've got another one of these coming up, obviously. We've got more movies on this list coming up, but I'll ask you. I'll throw it to you. This movie, what'd you think? Sounds like you hated it, but let me tell me what you think, and tell me if you think it belongs on the list.
This is my favorite Harry Potter book, and this is my favorite Harry Potter movie. And I think if you're going to put any Harry Potter movie on a list of greatest British films to represent that series, then this is absolutely the one to put on there. I find it strange that Deathly Hallows Part 2 is also on this list, but perhaps I will watch it again and be convinced that it deserves to be there. But like with James Bond on the BFI list, like as good as Dr. No ended up being, there's no reason for it to be on there. Goldfinger needs to be on there. That's the definitive James Bond movie. And I believe that Prisoner of Azkaban is the definitive Harry Potter movie. Brendan, over to you.
Well, thank you, Jason, for throwing it over to me. I will also say that this is the best Harry Potter movie, having seen all of these movies a whopping one time, and this movie two times. But I do think that this one stands out. And again, it's mostly because of the direction, mm-hmm. cinematography, the look of the movie. It's the first one that gets darker. I think actually the next one's pretty good, but it's a bit of a step back.
It's still pretty dark in places, I will say. Goblet certainly is, and Phoenix is even darker, and Half-Blood Prince is even darker.
I mean, like, quality-wise, I think the next one's step back. I don't know. Whatever one had, like, Robert Pattinson in it was pretty good.
That's Goblet, yeah.
Yeah, he was. That was a sad one.
Poor Cedric.
But, this movie's wonderful. It's so good, and there's lots going on, and it's relatable, and he does a great job of just making the fantasy realistic, and that's a very difficult thing to do. So I will say, and I'm with you, if you're going to put a Harry Potter on here, put this one on, because this is representative, I think, of the best that you can get with Harry Potter. And like you, I don't remember the last one very much, but we'll see when that comes up. We'll check it out and we'll talk about it. Maybe it has just as much of a right to be on here as this one. Right now, I don't think it does, but and I'm not saying it's a bad movie. I'm sure it's a great movie, and I remember it being really good, but we'll talk about it when we get to it. So, yeah.
Which may very well be next week.
May very well be next week, Jason, because what are we going to do right now?
Brendan, it is time to spin the wheel. And what we do here is Brendan has placed the remaining films onto a wheel, which he will spin with his hands. And randomly, a movie will appear in front of him when the wheel stops moving. And that movie will be the movie we watch. Brendan, over to you.
Again, thank you. Professionalism is off the charts this week. Yeah, so the remaining 27 movies that we have on this list. And I am going to spin the wheel, and we are going to make the deal and hope that it doesn't land on a coal miner's glove on a pole match. Here we go. Ooh. That's a deep cut for you, for you wrestling fans.
You better gimmick the wheel, brother.
I did not. Okay. Jason, I did not gimmick the wheel, but I couldn't be happier. Big spoiler for my opinion on this, but we are talking about, and it's perfect because we've already talked about the sequel on this podcast. Mm. We are going to be talking about Paddington next week.
Oh, sweet. I really enjoyed the second Paddington, so I bet you I will also enjoy the first.
I think you will. So get ready to have your heart lifted, and we're going to watch something not sad for once. Well, I guess this one wasn't sad, but we've watched a lot of sad movies.
Yeah, we have. Any time to have a heartwarming movie, we'll take it.
Exactly. So we are going to watch Paddington next week. But until then, Jason, they can find us all over social media. We're on Facebook. Just search for Screen.
And Gundre.
We're on Twitter at FSAC Pod, as in for Screen.
And Gundre.
Podcast. We are also on all of the podcast apps. Our home base, of course, is Age of Radio. You can go to ageofradio.org/forscreen.
And Gundre.
Jason, where can they find you?
They can find me over on Twitter at Jason D. McLeod. That is MacLeod. You could even follow me on Twitch. I don't do anything on Twitch. I just watch stuff occasionally, but I'm BD Swiggen. That is BDSWIGGEN. So go ahead and follow me over there if you like.
And great job at picking a name that is easy to spell upon hearing it and search for.
That's right. Absolutely.
So there you go. So we're going to talk about Paddington next week. Get ready. Get happy. Get fun. Get huggable. Get lovable. And until then, though, Jason, I will just say to you, God save the Queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
Give me a hug, teddy bear.
Thank you.
named Ramblin' Bob. He used to steal, gamble, and rob. He thought he was the smartest guy around. Well, I found out last Monday that Bob got locked up Sunday. They've got him in the jailhouse way downtown. He's in the jailhouse now. He's in the jailhouse now. Well, I told him once or twice to stop playing cards and a shooting dice. He's in the jailhouse now. His poker, a peanut, a whist, and yoker, but shooting dice was his favorite game.